Let's start this next section on what is called substitution with a little rule for integrals that is very specific to symmetric functions. So this is a very specific rule, but also a useful rule that can come in really handy if we happen to come across these very specific types of definite integrals. So I want to cover this. This comes up in this section just as another tool to put into our toolbox when doing integration, when we are integrating definite integrals across a symmetric bound of a symmetric function. So again, that's very specific, but again, useful if it happens to come up. So if we happen to have an even function and we consider an even function, let me zoom in a little bit here. If we consider an even function across a symmetric interval from negative a to a, so if we are integrating an even function, and remember that an even function is symmetric across the y-axis, this is going to be exactly equal to 2 times the integral from 0 to a. So let's just, here's an example down below of an even function. And again, very specific, right? I mean, we have to be exactly from negative a to a. We have to be exactly the same on either side of 0 here. We have to have the same distance on either side of 0, a symmetric interval, when we're looking at these functions of symmetric functions. So if that is true, then it turns out, obviously, that this area, R, is exactly the same as this area here because of the nature of the function. The function is even. And so what we can do is we can say, well, let's just consider this side from 0 to A and double it. Okay? So that's what it says. So, you know, an obvious even function, the easiest even function to think about is y equals x squared. And if we look at y equals x squared, obviously that is the parabola that is symmetric across the y-axis. And if we were to happen to look at it from, let's just go from negative 3 to 3, the integral from negative 3 to 3 of x squared dx, which we could compute, just use our fundamental theorem of calculus, but that is going to be exactly equal to 2 times the integral from 0 to 3 of x squared dx because of the nature of the symmetry here. So rather than going all the way from negative 3 to 3, we can say, let's just look at it from 0 to 3 and double it. There we go. Okay. All right. So that is what the symmetry here says. So the symmetry says that we can just double the integral from 0 to a rather than looking at it all the way from negative a to a. And that's useful because a lot of times when we're computing a definite integral, plugging in 0 is easier to do than plugging in a negative a. Okay? So with even functions, we can do that. Now, odd functions are even nicer to work with because of the way their symmetry works out. So remember that an odd function is symmetric through the origin. So if we look at an odd function such that f of negative x equals negative f of x. So if we look at an odd function, turns out that if we look at an odd function and we're calculating the definite integral across negative a to a, an odd function is going to be exactly zero because the same amount of area is going to be above the x-axis as below. And a definite integral, remember, represents the net area. So the net area is going to be zero for an odd function from negative a to a. So again, just thinking about what's our easiest odd function to look at visually, that would be x cubed. So if we were to look at x cubed, so here's y equals x cubed from x. Let's look at it symmetric through the origin, and let's look at it, let's do from negative 3 to 3, just like we did for x squared. If we integrate from negative 3 to 3 of x cubed dx, this is exactly equal to 0, because the same amount of area, because of the nature of the symmetry of odd functions, the same amount of area is going to be below the x-axis as above the x-axis, and this negative 3 to 3 is telling me that we're looking at the net area of this curve between the function and the x-axis from negative 3 to 3. Those two areas are going to cancel each other out. They're equal and opposite in magnitude here, and so they're equal to 0. And that gives us this really nice little symmetric application, an application of symmetry within definite integrals. So Let's look at a couple examples. There are not a lot of integrals that this will apply to because it's so specific, right? We're talking about you have to first identify that you have an even or odd function. Most functions are neither even or odd, right? Like they are actually not, it's a very specific type of function that is even or odd, okay? So first of all, you have to have an even or odd function, and it has to be from negative a to a. Now, if those two properties don't exist, then we can't apply this tool. But like I said, if it does, and we happen to see this, and as you're heading into the next branch of calculus, as you head into integral calculus, the more tools you have for calculating integrals, the better. And so if this were to come up and you could save yourself a lot of work, then it's worth knowing this rule, this tool. So let's take a look. So here we go. If we're looking at, let's change this to, since I already talked about x cubed, let's change this to x to the fifth. If we're looking at the integral from negative 5 to 5 of x to the fifth dx, the first thing I notice, I could absolutely, let's just mention that there is this option. I could absolutely go in here and do, okay, find the antiderivative, x to the 6 over 6, and evaluate that from negative 5 to 5, and dot, dot, dot. I could just use fundamental theorem of calculus and finish it out. Or if I recognize, first of all, that x to the fifth is in fact an odd function, and I am on a symmetric interval from negative 5 to 5, I could say, oh, well, this is exactly equal to 0. Look at how easy that was. This is equal to 0, and you know the justification here, of course, is since x to the fifth is an odd function. But that was so much easier, right, than going through this whole process that we could have done. All right, let's look at one more. What if I'm integrating cosine of x from negative pi over 2 to pi over 2? Well, the first thing I notice is that the cosine of x is even. It's an even function. Cosine is even, sine is odd. So if the cosine is an even function and I'm on a symmetric interval, negative pi over 2 to pi over 2, I can simply say that this is equal to 2 times the integral from 0 to pi over 2. It just makes the work a little bit easier. Again, we don't have to do that, right? We could have just powered it through with the fundamental theorem, but it does make the work a little bit easier. And now we can say, okay, well, that's just 2 times, and then the antiderivative or the integral, whoops, I lost my dx. The integral of the cosine of x with respect to x is just the sine of x, and we're going to evaluate that from 0 to pi over 2. And that is going to be 2 times the sine of pi over 2 minus the sine of 0, which is just 0, and 2 times 1 is 2. And again, just makes the work a little easier because plugging in 0 can often be more convenient or easier to do. Computation of functions evaluated at 0 tends to be easier. Well, not always, but it tends to be easier. Plugging in 0, easy. Okay. Okay, what if we had something like this, right? Like I notice this first of all, and I see, you know, the first thing when I'm coming across an integral, since you have to be across a symmetric interval, I always kind of look and I say, is it from, before I even think about even or oddness of the function, I think about, is this from negative a to a? And if it is, that's then when I go, okay, it is. So let me consider the function. Now, this particular function is neither even nor odd, but if I break it into its individual terms are, x to the fourth is obviously an even function. Sine of x, or sine of theta, it does have a 2x, that just changes the period, but sine of theta is in fact odd. So that's why together the functions are neither even nor odd. Together, as one complete function, it is neither even, it is cannot be classified as even or odd. But if I break it up, which we absolutely can do with integrals, we can break it up from negative 2 to 2 of x to the fourth minus negative 2 to 2 of the sine of 2x dx. Don't forget your differential on each one. Now, since this guy is even, the first term is even, I'm going to rewrite that, just point down there. This is exactly equal to 2 times the integral from 0 to 2 of x to the 4th dx by symmetry. And since this guy's odd, it's just 0. I mean, look at how easy that is, right? That's like the easiest integral to compute. The integral from negative 2 to 2 of sine of 2x, since it's odd, is just 0. It has to be. So then we just can finish it out. And this is 2 times x to the 5th over 5, evaluated from 0 to 2. So we've got 2 fifths times 32 minus 0, or 64 fifths. And that is my answer. And a little bit quicker, a little bit faster, we could have, of course, just applied the fundamental theorem. If we had just done FTOC, fundamental theorem of calculus, just my abbreviation there. If I had done that, I would have ended up with x to the 5th over 5 plus cosine of 2x, and then because of that 2x, I'd have that 1/2, and then I'd have to evaluate that from negative 2 to 2, dot, dot, dot. We would get to the same answer, but this just gets us there a little bit faster, just applying this symmetric rules for symmetry across intervals from negative a to a, across also symmetric functions across symmetric intervals. Okay? And so it does just give us a nice little tool, just a tool to add into our handy integration toolbox. So we will just end by projecting even functions and odd functions of across symmetric intervals.